tonight I decided to do something a little slightly different than what I usually do, which probably can explain the fact that we're not so many, which I really appreciate. But you know, it's different in the sense that I mean, these Think Olio events are basically meant to just popularize philosophy or sociology or humanities in general. So the subject that we would pick would often be already kind of exciting, fun, entertaining, so to say. I have to say tonight is not going to be entertaining. I'm sorry to disappoint. I tell you right away. This is, you know, despite the great publicity I've just, you know, had to hear about myself, this is not going to be something light. This is not going to be something where we're just going to throw our own experiences and ideas in there. For once, I just decided that it might be nice for us to really learn something with some more content, some more density. And I know it's Halloween night and you might probably be willing to, you know, have a drink. Well, you can have a drink. That's, you know, that's not exclusive. But I think it's also interesting to just try to speak about philosophers that that a lot of people have been actually misunderstood, and that you might, I'm sure, have heard already of the name Nietzsche, of the name Hannah Arendt, and you probably, you know, read a couple of articles about it or just heard some people say something about it, pretty banal, which we're gonna speak about, obviously. And sometimes these interpretations or these popularizing, you know, approaches of Nietzsche and Arendt specifically can be very misleading. So my role tonight is really to just to try to give you some content about these two philosophers that I think are absolutely essential to the question of evil. And to make sure that you get out of this class, basically, I don't like to call it a class, but it's kind of a class this time, I have to say, as opposed to usually, with some kind of introductory, you know, background about these two philosophers. This is my goal. So, again, why would I choose, you know, these two philosophers? Well, as you very well know about the topic of evil in general, I would say that our judgments might often be misled when we qualify certain people as evil. This is a tricky concept to begin with, right? I'm not gonna speak about that in general because I want to focus on two philosophers particularly, but this is a very weird word, evil. We use it to stigmatize people, we use it to describe certain things, but we rarely use it to explain a certain type of behavior. Actually, we often use it because we lack an explanation of a certain behavior. So this theme has been kind of haunted me, you know, for a couple of years now. And I just noticed that we often just ignore the historical and social structures which have shaped the concept of evil, right? So that's where I think Hannah Arendt and Nietzsche are very useful in order to really reconsider, like contextualize, you know, the situation in which we begin to speak about evil, for what reason, and from where evil itself can stem. So why picking again these two authors? Because first of all, their books, you might have, you know, heard about their main books, you know, obviously you have Beyond Good and Evil for Nietzsche, so that speaks directly about evil. For Hannah Arendt, you might have heard about the banality of evil, which is a very common, you know, saying, and it's taken from the title of the famous book Eichmann in Jerusalem, a report on the banality of evil, 1963. And just for information, for Nietzsche, it's 1886 for the Beyond Good and Evil. So, first of all, their book says a lot about the fact that they were very concerned with this theme. Then they also have this skeptical approach that I told you about that really interests me. And also, as I told you, because of many misunderstandings about these two authors, not only about their general ideas, as I just said, but also with their relationship to Nazism. Very often you think like Nietzsche is some kind of philosopher that has influenced Hitler or something like this. That's something I hear actually a lot. And you know, regarding to Hannah Arendt, you know, we assume that she said a lot of things about the Holocaust, and we might, you know, actually dissipate some misunderstandings here as well. What also made me take these two philosophers together is the fact that they have one similar thesis, though defended very differently, which is a very, I would say, counterintuitive thesis, They think that evil somehow is closely tied up with mediocrity. When we think of evil, we don't think mediocrity at all. We think excess. We think we try to describe extreme inhumane barbarity beyond explanation. We can find reasons, and that's why evil is very often connected to madness or bestiality, to something irrational by definition, right? We use it to describe people, actions that we cannot comprehend very often. But Nietzsche and Arendt, I think both, try to risk the explanation, try to look for rational causes behind using the word evil and behind also evil actions themselves. So I'm going to give you a little handout. We're going to work tonight. I'm telling you. So here you go. So these are some quotes. I'm not going to comment on all of them, but I'm going to comment on most of them. Actually, you're going to comment on some of them. So you're going to have some homework to do with me tonight, guys. So not for now. I'm going to tell you which ones exactly at what moment, okay, that I want you to look at and just try to think for yourself. What did Nietzsche mean with that? You know, these two lines, you just like read it for yourself and you discuss with somebody next to you, try to see what it means. Same for Hannah Arendt, okay? So we'll get to that in a second. For now, again, let's go back on Nietzsche. So let's begin with him. He's one of the most celebrated evil skeptic, right? So obviously that made him, you know, a good choice. He's also a philologist. And that leads me to the first quote. Do you see the first quote in Nietzsche? Okay, can you read it out loud? Maybe, I don't know. Tiffany? Did you get the paper? Everybody has one? Who's missing one? Everybody should have a handout. Do you have more over there? That's it? Okay, so I have more here. No, that's fine. You're more than I expected. Here we go. So first quote. Go for it, Michael.
Good and evil that are not transitory do not exist.
All right, I give you a few minutes, okay? Speak with your neighbor. Try to tell me what you think that means. Go ahead, you have 2 minutes. Let's go for it, guys, just like that. Don't think too much for now. What could that mean? What could that mean? Yes, go ahead.
I think it means that good and evil are not dichotomous. So
what do you mean by that?
One person cannot be all good or all bad or all evil.
That's not exactly what he means. Well tried. Well tried. That's a good try. Not exactly. Because that would assume that good and evil actually exist as independent categories already, to say that. Okay, that there are objective categories, if you say something like this. Whereas what Nietzsche is saying, anybody wants to try, yeah?
So these are perhaps the expressions of impulses that are very transitory and temporary.
They're temporary, exactly. He's trying to defend a type of relativism here, okay? So we tend to think of moral concepts like good and evil as stable, grounded somehow in some fixed set of universal values existing independently of our wills, our impulses, exactly. But no, not for Nietzsche at least. Our moral concepts are mere human inventions, including the moral concepts. They have always been fluid, transitory, that's what he means with. So it's not so much like within the person, but as concepts that just change reference. Okay? They have a long genealogy and evolutionary as well history. So this is really a defense of relativism, of morality. Good and evil, actually, to go back to the impulse thing you just said, are mostly the expression of appetites and aversion. On the one hand, good would be what people desire, and on the other hand, evil would be, you know, people would use the word evil in order to describe what they fear or what they want to avoid, what basically they just, you know, disregard or something that's not benefiting them, okay? So then they are obviously ratified by a society's central authority that decrees arbitrarily, this is what we're going to call good, this is what we're going to call evil. what type of behavior or character those two concepts might refer to. Okay? So in that regard, I would say that Nietzsche is not the first one to say that. If you read Machiavelli, if you read Hobbes, you find very similar theses already where good and evil are established concepts and their meaning changes historically depending on which people are in power and can therefore appropriate them. Questions so far? Okay. So most of our values today in the way we conceive morality as are inherited, obviously, from religious morality. And that's what Nietzsche is going to be speaking about. In Nietzsche, you find very famously a virulent critique of the general Christian authority that appropriated this concept of good and evil and give them, according to Nietzsche, a very questionable meaning. We're going to try to see what he means. So just to have that in mind, you really have to understand that Nietzsche considers himself as what he calls a hammer philosopher. So basically, he takes a hammer and he just breaks down every single value that the traditional morality is putting forth. So all the, you know, I don't know, generosity, humility, all these values, these virtues that you're traditionally, you know, used to hear as great virtues, Nietzsche arrives and just destroys them, okay? He's just the philosopher of the hammer. He describes himself as an annihilator. A machine to annihilate. Though, and that will be my first remark against one misunderstanding about Nietzsche, he's not a nihilist. What is a nihilist? Maybe you don't say nihilist in English. See? Thank you. Nihilist. What is a nihilist? Since you know how to pronounce it, you probably know also what it means. Go ahead, I'm all ears. Ha!
Oui,
that's a real simple, that's a little too simplistic. But that would be somebody that doesn't believe in anything, that doesn't value anything more than anything else, and just puts everything in the same disregard, at the same level of disregard, so to say. This is not the case with Nietzsche. He definitely values certain things over others. So he's not a nihilist in... nihilist in that sense. Okay, so just that's the first common misunderstanding I wanted to point out. Indeed, he values another type of morality than the Judeo-Christian morality that we're all basically used to and that we still more or less, you know, inherited. So this morality he values, he calls it the master morality. It's a type of higher morality of the strong, an aristocratic morality. I will come back to that in a second. And this morality is definitely fundamentally different from what he calls the slave morality, which is basically the Judeo-Christian morality that we're in today, okay? Which is, for him, a morality of the herd, of conformism, of the weak morality as we know it, he says. So now don't forget, Nietzsche is not only a philosopher, but he's also a philologist. A philologist is someone who questions the origin of the words and where they come from and the evolution of language and the evolution of the meanings of the world. So he loves to do that. And he notices, looking way back, that actually good and bad meant different things before than they do today. Originally, good meant noble. It referred to wealth, vigor and force. And originally, bad meant just mediocre, the opposite, trivial, coming from a trivial rabble, basically. That's what good and bad originally meant. So the original morality was a master morality, says Nietzsche, a knightly, so to say, or like a warrior, an aristocratic morality coming from the early rulers and conquerors who judged their own power, wealth, and success to be good, and the poverty and wretchedness of those they ruled over to be bad. Okay? So that's kind of the historical perspectives he takes for now. And then there has been an inversion of values. So how did that happen? Why? So I want you to look at the quote 4 right now, if you can, please. Beginning with, when a decadent type of man, I would like somebody to read that out loud, please. Draper, I'm all ears.
When a decadent type of man ascended to the rank of the highest type, this could only happen at the expense of its counterpart. the type of man that is strong and sure of life. When the herd animal is irradiated by the glory of the purest virtue, the exceptional man must have been devaluated into evil.
Okay, that's a long quote now. So I give you a little time to digest it and try to see what maybe Nietzsche has meant with that. I give you this time maybe 3 minutes and not two. Go ahead. All right, anyone? So again, I'm sorry, I have to say the style of Nietzsche is sometimes a little, you know, indigest. It's a lot of, you know, rhetorics and big adjectives and just a lot of visceral feelings. Also, you can feel that when you read Nietzsche, which makes him a very difficult philosopher actually, which is why we're speaking about him tonight, and make sure you don't misinterpret what he says. So anybody has an idea of what that can mean? That's a tough one. Yes, go ahead.
When we celebrate one person as being good, we're implying that the opposite of that is what we consider evil.
Yes, indeed. Who is here the decadent type of man? Would that be somebody from the slave morality or the master morality?
Slave.
The slave morality. So the decadent type of man here is the weak that has ascended to the rank of the highest type, thanks to what? Thanks to religion, says Nietzsche. This could only happen at the expense of its counter-type, namely the master, the strong, the aristocratic, the one that used to be called good before, needs to be called bad now, in order by the weak, in order for the weak to assert its power over him. Do you understand that mechanism? I'm going to try to explain it more. So this slave morality arised originally from what he called ressentiment. He used actually a French word to describe that, ressentiment, which is called resentment. It's like a mix of fear, hatred, envy, that leads to desire of revenge. Indeed, the weak was tired of living in the shadow of the strong all the time, and they decided to rebel, which created this inversion of value. Okay, this inversion of values. So historically, the slave morality originates with priests, says Nietzsche. Again, here I'm not, just a little parenthesis. I am not taking sides. I'm here to give you some information objectively, I mean, as objectively as I can, given the fact that my interpretation might be biased to a certain extent, but I'm really not trying to tell you what I think. I'm trying to tell you what Nietzsche thinks. Maybe after we can have a discussion about what we think about Nietzsche, okay? So historically, again, the slave morality originates with priests, so he says, who despised this warrior caste, the strong, and condemned their power as being evil. So evil was the label that they pinned onto the strong in order to assert their power, while calling good, obviously, their own state of powerlessness, of weakness, and they called self-denial and things like that, for instance, good. That's when meekness, humility, began to refer to goodness, in a way, which was not the case before. So he takes a very famous metaphor, the metaphor of the lambs over the birds of prey. And so he describes the lambs who are like, oh, we're tired of getting always attacked by these eagles and all by these birds of prey. I mean, why are you doing that? And the eagles are like, this is what we do. This is, I mean, it's in our nature. We're strong. We have strength over you. We exert that strength. That's nature, period. And the lambs are like, yeah, but I mean, come on. We are nice. We don't kill. And the eagles say, yeah, but you don't kill not because you have some kind of moral, you know, softness inside of you or something like loftiness inside of you. You don't kill just because you are unable to kill. You're just too weak naturally and you can't kill. And so you envy my position, but I'm not responsible for that, dude. Basically, that's the idea here. So the metaphor here goes then on to say that, well, the lamb, in order to basically find some kind of power back over, or not back, some kind of power for the first time over the eagles, had to invent something for the eagles to stop, you know, attacking them. So they were like, let's create something stronger than them. We're going to call it God. We're going to call it God. It's going to be like this huge superpower that's going to punish them if they continue to attack us. And so smart, weak, you know, physically, but smart mentally, the lambs decided to reunite and make their story about God credible enough for the eagles or the birds of prey to just fall prey to it, basically, and invert that way the values, okay? So that would be the Old Testament God, for instance, the God of wrath, would be an invention to scare the strong. And then the New Testament God, the God of love, would be an invention to soften the strong, to make them like more, you know, calmer in a way, to sneak in some empathy into them. So Christian love, empathy for Nietzsche in a way, it's an imperative that benefits the weak, and it's originally born from hatred, from ressentiment, from envy, according to Nietzsche. So this also like can be actually traced back to other philosophers, Plato, not Plato himself, but one character that he puts in his dialogue called Callicles. And Callicles says exactly that already. He said that the inferior employ morality to pull down those who are naturally better. It's kind of the same thing. The weaker folk, the majority, frame the laws for their own advantage, in order to frighten the strong by saying that to overreach others is shameful and evil. So the chief means by which the weak and mediocre weaken and pull down the stronger is the moral judgment and the use of the word evil in a sense that benefit them, obviously. So moral concepts such as good and evil simply reflect the fear, the hate, the envy I just described, who are unable of people, of the weak, who are unable to do what the strong can do. They opt instead, for want of anything better, to put the actions of the strong under the ban of morality. This is Nietzsche's explanation. Do you have any like questions so far, maybe? Is it clear enough? Okay, good. Because that's not easy to understand, especially because when you read Nietzsche, guys, I don't know why he employs the same term, morality, to describe at the same time slave morality and master morality. And sometimes he doesn't put the adjective slave or master in front of it. So you don't know exactly what he's referring to. Okay, so that's why it makes actually the reading extremely complicated. So one little remark about this, which is, you know, where Nietzsche gets a little problematic for, you know, today's world and the democracy we live in. To give themselves credibility, the weak need to make their weakness the norm. What I mean by that is that they have to level down and make everyone believe that we are all equals. So democracy for Nietzsche is a type of political Christianity, so to say, that puts everyone on the same level where naturally they are absolutely not, according to Nietzsche. So indeed, one of the most problematic characteristics of the slave morality is that it assumes that there is like an essential similarity between people and that we all have the same dignity, so to say. Most moral theories, you know, actually all moral theories, I would say, aim at universal principles, valid for all. But in reality, these theories embrace norms that harm the highest men, according to Nietzsche again, while benefiting the lowest, who pulls the highest down. So pretending to determine what is good and what is evil for everyone, according to a unique human nature, supposedly as if we are all equal, is either naive, says Nietzsche, or hypocritical. For all, we are very, very different. And here, just to help you memorize that, think we're like, you know, 19th century, Darwin just came up with a lot of ideas that Nietzsche has read. Survival of the fittest, you have that behind as a background kind of theory that influences tremendously Nietzsche in terms of him thinking of us not being equal at all, naturally, physically, in terms of abilities, okay? So basically, evil is the translation of the will to power of the weak, stigmatizing the strong with that label to make the strong feel guilty and get in line. So one second common misunderstanding about Nietzsche right here. People often think of him as a kind of a dangerous eugenist that wants like to make the race better, right? Okay. That's why a lot of people read Nietzsche through a Nazi lens, so to say, and it has been done indeed. But Nietzsche never had the time even to promote Nazism at all. First of all, he died right before that happened. But it's his sister who, when the poor guy became crazy because he died, you know, kind of mad, he actually fell, you know, on his knees in front of a horse and in awe, and just like felt like a great empathy, which is kind of weird coming from this guy, right? But whatever, because the horse was getting beaten in the street, and then he just went mad. And the sister took care of him, and the sister was a member of the Nazi party, and she collected several writings from Nietzsche and made a book called The Will to Power that you might have heard of, which is not a book written from Nietzsche at all. It's a collection, it's a mosaic of quotes picked here and there in some notes that the sister found in order to kind of make it sound like Nietzsche was defending a kind of anti-Semitism, which he certainly wasn't. So just for your information. So, according to Nietzsche, basically, evil is a dangerous concept, which is going to be my conclusion about him. Why? Because it condemns life. It's an anti-natural, anti-life type of concept, because what is qualified as evil are often just vital principles. The very first instincts of life, as he says. Sexuality, for instance. We are taught to experience the presupposition of life, sexuality, namely sexuality, he says, as something unclean. Self-love, and that's the quote too in the handout I gave you, where he says, slave morality looks for the evil principle in what is most profoundly necessary for growth, in severe self-love. We need to, self-love is a natural thing, and there is nothing wrong about that, he says. And it condemns not only life in general, the slave morality, but also the best forms of life. It has a negative effect on individual potential and vitality because it pulls you down. It makes mediocrity the norm. It makes us live in fear of being condemned for wanting to step out of the crowd. And it distracts us from enjoying the present, and improving ourselves no matter what other people might think. So those are the values really that Nietzsche defends over the slave morality values. Now we're going to get to Arendt, but I want to know if you have any questions about Nietzsche before that. Yes?
Can you speak a little bit to how he defines the weak versus the strong in the first place? What constitutes mediocrity? Relative too?
It's mainly physiological. So again, 19th century, it's always good to have a little bit of history of science, you know, at the same time, because that tremendous, it's not like philosophers just pop out, you know, out of any context. They always are, you know, their thought is obviously contextualized, right? So at the same time, you had a lot of new discovery about anatomy, you had a lot of new discovery about physiology and how the body works, and he was very interested into that. And for him, the physiology, your anatomy is going to determine your psychology. So a weak person would be somebody with a weak, physiology, basically, that also is going to reflect on his psychology. Though he says sometimes that actually the weak physically have to be smarter in order to compensate their physical weakness. And that's where Nietzsche is annoying, because he always contradicts himself. So it really depends which passage you pick. But it's a very, I would say, strength and weakness are really seen as something, before anything else, physical, I would say. Physical, and in order also of in terms of like creativity, in terms of how you expand yourself, how the examples he takes as over men, which is a theme I'm not going to get into because I'm not going to make a whole class on only Nietzsche, okay? But just the over man would be a person that's creative, such as Beethoven, for instance, was creative, or Wagner was creative. He takes the example of Wagner, obviously, as the perfect example of the over man, the creative man, the strong man, not because he was just a strong dude, but also because he's very creative. He doesn't care about what people think. He's not a member of the herd. He hates conformism. He just creates for his own sake, driven by some kind of strengths. You know what I'm saying? He also tells that himself is a good example of Hoverman, which is kind of obviously, yeah. But that's questionable, given the fact that the guy was actually extremely sick. Huh? He had a very weak health, Nietzsche, which is kind of funny when you think about it. Any other question?
I I'm sort of curious about like attachment. Like a lot of this stuff is sort of like positioned as like you're strong or weak, but not like, you know, what you, how you attach to people gives you like motivation or confidence to actually do those other things. And it's like sort of like you're this individual and you're stuck either strong or weak, and not kind of like what you're attached to influences that.
In regard to free will, you mean?
Yeah, like, really, like we all have parents, and there's always a yearn to be connected with them, right? Versus like I'm just an individual. Yeah. Is that connected with you at all?
You mean like, are we able to change, to go off the path, the determinist path of our physiology? Is that what you're saying? Or I might be business misunderstanding.
I guess the attachments with other individuals kind of influencing that balance between what's strong and weak.
Yeah, okay. Not within the individual only. Alors, that's exactly what we're going to get into with Arendt, which completes beautifully the work of Nietzsche on that aspect. Yes. But that's not Nietzsche. No, you're good? Yes.
So how does he, with his, I'm trying to get straight, what are his feelings about rape then?
Yeah, like, because he could say that's an instinct.
And it's an instinct, it's a life force, or rule, laws against rape, anti-life, in his eyes.
The type of strength that he values, again, is not only just like to submit yourself to impulses and natural impulses, it's also to be able to get to another level of creation. Creativity is he's a very interesting philosopher also, because he's the only philosopher that speaks about dance. He values the dancer. He says that he's a dancer philosopher. He's also a philosopher of the hammer, but also a dancer philosopher, like a shooting star type of philosopher. He describes himself actually that way, saying that it's really about just going like over that material world and just shooting for something way above that. That's why he calls it the Übermensch, the overman, is somebody that aims at something higher, like Wagner was doing, in aesthetical term, very, very much an aesthetical thinker, Nietzsche. So that's the type of strength that he would value. And this is actually another common misunderstanding about Nietzsche. This is good that you mentioned that. It's not like he only values exclusively and totally embraces master morality and totally disregards or despises slave morality. It's not that simple. It's not, there is no such dichotomy into Nietzsche. He's warning us about certain dangers that the slave morality has. And that's why probably about rape, I think he would probably say that it's understandable, but it's not obligatory excusable or something like this. He would consider, and it depends like the circumstances in which it's done. If rape is done as a type of thing where you want to prove your strength or something like that, you know, to reach power over somebody, that would be actually from resentment in a way as well. Like you just want to prove yourself something, and that's weak according to Nietzsche. So. You see, it really depends what are the motives. Yes?
Does he have any warnings against the master morality? Or no, only just the slave morality?
Yes, the warning he had was against narcissism. Yeah, where this like pride or self-love that he spoke, you know, about in good terms a second ago, right? He says that can also, the risk is to fall into some type of narcissism, which is something he accused his friend and later enemy Wagner of towards the end of their relationship. Yes. All right. So Hannah Arendt. Alors, why? Again, do I put them together? First of all, both Nietzsche and Arendt, I think, certainly share a very, you know, very deeply rooted, disenchanted, you know, perspective about the modern world. That's one thing for sure. For both of them also, evil comes from the homogenization of people, from the, I don't know if that's a word, but I'm gonna try it, disindividualization of people, like from individuals we're gonna make just a mass of people that are gonna just live in conformity. And so this relates to what you were saying a little earlier. And this massifying effect also obviously create a certain type of mediocrity, according to Nietzsche and to Arendt. But their ideas differ greatly. First of all, mainly, I would say, Arendt doesn't put into question the generally accepted moral values that we inherited from Judeo-Christianism. She doesn't put that into question. What she questions is not so much the legitimacy of using the word evil. She says, okay, there are some stuff we can definitely qualify as evil. But the origin of what is often considered as the epitome of evil, namely the Holocaust. That's what she focuses on, and that's what we're going to be speaking about here. She agrees to describe some Nazis, you know, as not obligatory evil people, but she agrees to say that they did evil things, for sure. But she tries to understand what triggered this evil doing. She tries to go beyond just stating that evil is like an inherent quality of an individual. Maybe it can come from social structures, and that's what we're going to get into right now. So, what's interesting about her approach is that, a little bit like Nietzsche, she refuses to associate evil with some idea of inhumane, demoniac tendency. That's in your quote 3. If you can read that one. I don't know if you have it right there. Can you read it out loud, maybe? Eh? No, the third one.
Evil possesses neither death nor any demonic dimension. It can overrule and lay waste the whole world precisely because it spreads like a fungus.
Like a mushroom. She uses the mushroom metaphor a lot. Mm-hmm.
It is thought defying, as I said, because thought tries to reach some depth, to go to the roots, and the moment it concerns itself with evil, it is frustrated because there is nothing. That is its banality.
So evil is not inside of a person, as some sort of, I don't know, genetic feature that you would have some people, which we don't even deserve the name of people anymore, would have in themselves. Evil stems from somewhere else, and it has to do with the relationship that we have in certain political structures. Okay, so instead of thinking of evil as this demonic tendency that we might have within ourselves, that would be like rooted in our character, so to say, she speaks about what very, I would say, philosophical commonplace nowadays called the banality of evil. So I'm gonna, what do you think she means with that, the banality of evil? I'm sure you have heard about these two social psychologic experiments, namely the Milgram experiment and the Stanford experiment. These two guys, so Milgram on the one hand and Zimbardo who did the Stanford experiment on the other, were clearly based on what Anna Arendt tried to prove in her books. Okay, they were greatly influenced by Anna Arendt. So now what do these two experiments show? Who doesn't know these experiments? Raise your hand. Okay, great. So maybe someone wants to speak about the Milgram experiment very quick. Yes, go ahead.
Both experiments were based on authority and listening to authority figures. The Milgram experiment was you were placed in a room and told that you had to press a button and it would eventually start to shock someone, possibly into death, and you were kind of pressed into doing this and, you know, told if you don't, things are, you know, you're going to get in trouble, et cetera, et cetera. And the prison experiment at Stanford with Zimbardo, basically a group was split, prisoners and staff, and more or less left to see how they would behave in those circumstances. And the half of the group that was assigned as guards really just became very violent and awful to the group that was assigned as prisoners. And it was really interesting to see how normalized that behavior came within the group. Mm-hmm.
So yeah, the Milgram experiment, indeed, it's not so much that the authority figure, namely in that case science was a scientist close to the person that was pushing the button to send some electric charges to the person who actually ends up faking, obviously dying, because it was obviously an actor. The experiment was about the person, like, until what point am I gonna just shock that person, right? And the experiment showed that a lot of people go to like the very end. So the Milgram experiment is actually, the methodology behind it is okay, even if like every social, every experiment in social psychology is always questionable, but definitely the Stanford experiment was just a setting. It's pure, this is not an experiment. It doesn't deserve the word scientific at all. Huh? It was just, the guards were already told kind of what to do, because the goal of Zimbardo was to just denounce the violence in prison. So he already had a goal. He wanted to prove that, and he wanted to have the label science on it in order to make himself more. Though, so you must have heard about this expression, the banality of evil, and you might think that banality of evil means just that, like there is some kind of, all of us basically, any of us can have can behave in an evil way depending on the circumstance of authority that you're put under. Okay, well, fair enough. This is, I would say, a little more complex than that. There is also another thing that people might think when they hear the expression banality of evil, is that the Holocaust itself was unexceptional or something like this. Again, this is not something that Hannah Arendt is saying at all. Okay, so let's again try to see exactly what she meant with this expression, the banality of evil. So she takes the example of this guy called Eichmann that you might have heard of. He was one of the Nazis that organized basically the deportation and transportation of the Jews to the Nazi concentration and experimentation camps, to the point that actually Himmler at the end of the war said no, we are losing the war, stop the solution finale, the final solution, and he kept going until the very end. So, an interesting character. So in 1960, Eichmann was captured in Argentina by the Mossad, so the Israeli intelligence service. He was tried, found guilty, and hanged in 1962 in Jerusalem for that crime against humanity that I just mentioned. And Arendt went to Jerusalem in 61 to report on this trial for the New Yorker. And then it became a book called A Report on the Banality of Evil, Eichmann in Jerusalem, A Report on the Banality of Evil, that was published in 1965. In that book, and in this article that constitute the book, she argues that desk murderers such as Eichmann were not motivated by demonic or monstrous motives. You have to imagine how controversial that was at the time to say something like this. According to Arendt, Eichmann's motives and character were banal or mediocre rather than monstrous. She describes the way he was speaking, full of cliché and stereotypes, and that he looked just like a bureaucrat, an efficient employee, very industrious, very zealous actually in his work, obeying to the hierarchy, and just like being, just a cog or a means, a link between as part of this whole Nazi system, right? So he embodied, as she says, I quote, the dilemma between the unspeakable horror of the deeds and the undeniable ludicrousness of the man who perpetrated them. I'm going to ask you to look at quote one, and to try to see what she was trying to say here. Can you read it out loud for us, Sam, please?
Sure. The greatest evil perpetrated is the evil committed by nobodies, that is, the human beings who refuse to be persons.
Okay. So what does she mean by refuse to be persons? Think about it for a second. Maybe discuss with the person next to you on that, and let me know your thoughts. All right. What do you think she's trying to say here? Human beings who refuse to be persons. She says human beings, so they're not monsters, they're human beings. Human beings who refuse to be persons. Yes?
I would put it in terms of a person not being a citizen, so I think to our discussion about taking responsibility, the same thing, you have a role of being not only human, but a person. And are you taking responsibility for the choices or actions that you enact on whether you
So person somehow is a concept that implies some kind of political role and sense of responsibility. Yes, person indeed has a moral connotation in the history of philosophy, way more than if I say an individual or people or, I don't know, someone, you know. A person, that very term, indeed is related to morality, but it is also related to thinking. Indeed, I think that Arendt here is basing herself on what Aristotle says. Aristotle says that what defines us as human being, the main property or the main function of human beings in comparison to the rest of other living beings, is the fact that we're able to reason, to think. And that makes us persons, specifically. Okay? So the specificity of human beings here, really, that I think she's trying to focus on more than the moral responsibility that comes after, it's going to be following from that, is really the ability to think critically. By thinking, I mean think critically, obviously, just not imagine or something. I have a very specific definition of thinking, you know, that I'm going to explain to you that Hannah Arendt is defending. And here I quote, she says, "It was sheer thoughtlessness, something by no means identical with stupidity." So again, huh? "It was sheer thoughtlessness, something by no means identical with stupidity, that predisposed Eichmann to become one of the greatest criminals of that period." Thoughtlessness. What she's trying to say is that evil happens when human beings are made into living corpses, basically, into cogs, who lack any spontaneity, freedom, and ability to think critically. And this happens specifically, she says, within totalitarian regimes. So what she blames here is not so much the person, she does too, we're gonna get to that again, but it's the institution behind the person's behavior. Okay? So Arendt's analysis on evil focuses on evils that are the result of political systems, mainly, not of genetical dispositions at all. And indeed, the totalitarian ideology says what? It aims at manufacturing a new human race. And therefore, by doing that, it eliminates all individual for the sake of the species. It annihilates all the parts for the sake of the whole. That's a typical, you know, feature of the totalitarian ideology. It also has the pretension to explain everything and to access like some kind of unshakable or absolute truth. So it forces you to dogmatically accept something. And that goes with many means, propaganda, etc., etc., that really just destroy, so to say, your ability to think. She says again, the essence of totalitarian government and perhaps the nature of every bureaucracy is to make functionaries and mere cogs in the administrative machinery out of men, and thus to dehumanize them. So why does she say bureaucracy here? She insists on the fact that in bureaucratic, you know, societies, and that's why her criticism on totalitarianism is also subtly, not so subtly sometimes, a criticism of any type of bureaucratic system, any type of political system where basically the tasks are being segmented, where basically there is like a bureaucratic specialization that everybody has a specific job, and it destroys any feeling of responsibility because the responsibility of anything that would be done by the government is kind of dissipated throughout all the members of the society participating in it. And it does suspend moral consciousness, obviously. She says again, I quote, "The aim of totalitarian education has never been to instill convictions, but to destroy the capacity to form any." Okay, to destroy the capacity to form any. Alors, careful here, possible misunderstandings. So, she says again, she says that it's not stupidity that led Eichmann to actually commit evil things. So again, here we have to be careful what she means with thoughtlessness, okay? If you see like the quote number two, the rhetorical question she's asking, can you read it out loud, somebody else? I'm tired of listening to my own voice. Yeah.
Go ahead. "Is evil doing possible in default of not just base motives, but of any motives whatever? Might the problem of good and evil, our faculty for telling right from wrong, be connected from our faculty of thought?"
So it's obviously a rhetorical question. She means, yes, it is connected with our faculty of thinking, our ability to think. But also, this is where I'm adding a little nuance based on other stuff she has written, also on our will to think. Remember, she says that he refuses to think, right? The first quote you read from Hannah Arendt, he refuses to be a person. It's not like he's not a person and, you know, he is passively just, you know, a victim of the system, basically. No, you also consciously refuse to think. So he was not just an idiot, but he was mediocre for sure. And he refused to think because he wanted to simply belong to the herd that had given him responsibilities and power that he never had before. So her analysis does address the culpability or the guilt, sorry, of individuals who take part in the perpetuation of evil. It's not only about the system. She doesn't blame only the institutions, but relatively to their refusal to think, always. She was convinced that Eichmann had to be punished. She never put that into question. She was definitely convinced of his guilt. But his refusal to think was triggered by the political regime he was in. So she's basically saying two things. She's like, yeah, yeah, he's totally guilty. She's never saying it's not his fault, because she could not possibly have said something like this and being published in the New Yorker, period. Okay, that's one thing. But also, I really don't think she meant that. I don't think that she tried to just, you know, victimize somehow Eichmann and say he was just, you know, basically poor thing, he was just an idiot, that's it. No, she definitely, there are two different things there. His mediocrity was already implanted as a seed, and let's say that totalitarian regime actually made that seed grow. That's how I would see it. It's a mix of nature and nurture, so to say. But the nature aspect is not evil as a seed, it's mediocrity. Then when, you know, we pour some totalitarian water on it, it grows as a beautiful plant of evil. Sorry, that was a shitty metaphor. I'm just tired. Bon. So, basically, if I want to sum up what I was trying to say, it was Eichmann's mediocrity within a totalitarian regime encouraging this mediocrity that was responsible for his inability to judge in those circumstances where judgment obviously was most needed. So basically, if we really want to go back on what banality of evil means for Arendt, I would say it has two meanings. One, evil is banal within totalitarian regimes because it becomes the norm. And that goes with, actually, your quote number 4 on your handout, when she says, evil in the Third Reich had lost the quality by which most people recognize it, namely temptation. That's the usual, you know, definition for evil, temptation and all that. The Nazis redefined it as a civil norm. So she means banality in that sense, because evil becomes accepted, routinized, so to say, normalized, committed in a daily way, mechanically, systematically. So that's one way of understanding the word banality. And the second one is about the people who give up this ability to think. And unfortunately, they are often common people, more than monstrous, you know, demons. They are ordinary, mediocre people that can be regular sources of evil, of the greatest evil, if put into the specific circumstances of totalitarianism. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. So this totalitarianism encouraged the mediocrity by inciting their thoughtlessness, so to say. So what Arendt actually should have said, I think, instead of speaking about the banality of evil, maybe she should have been speaking about the evil of banality, so to say. It's not so much the banality of evil, but the evil of banality, like the evil that mediocrity, banality can give rise to. Okay, maybe that helps to understand, to actually invert the two worlds. So what is banal is a failure to think. And the failure to think not only leads to evil, but is evil within itself. Because the consequences of thoughtlessness can lead to genocides. So again, like, she suggests really a redefinition of the activity of thinking here. And, you know, she insists, I think that's the misunderstanding that we need to get out of the way, she insists on the fact that Eichmann did act with consciousness, with awareness. He knew what he was doing, definitely. But he was not thinking in the sense that he refused to use his ability to judge morally and to reflect rationally on his actions. So he knew what he was doing. He was aware, he knew that, you know, that he was sending, you know, Jews to be burned, no problem, but he didn't realize, because he was trained not to, by totalitarianism, to actually make judgment over that. So evil comes from humans who are able to implement policy, but who no longer have intentions. So thinking also, that's what she means with thinking. It's to have intentions, to think reflectively about one's actions as a political being, whose own life and thinking is bound up with the life and thinking of others, which is why person also means citizen in the sense you just mentioned. So thinking or being conscious implies taking into account the collective we. It's an exercise of critical judgment that takes into account and cares about the common good. Now, I have some criticism about that, because I do actually think, and tell me if you disagree, that the people at the head of totalitarian regimes, for most of them, actually not only knew obviously what they were doing, but were convinced that they were doing for the good of the collectivity. They were convinced. And that led me to a book that I really recommend you for you to read. It's not a great book, but it's a fun book to read. It's called, the French is La Part de l'Autre, but it's called The Alternative Hypothesis. I don't know if you heard about that. No, it's by Eric Emmanuel Schmidt, and it's like this kind of double book. It's a novel / historical book where Eric Emmanuel Schmidt like tries a thought experiment where he thinks, okay, what would have happened if Hitler would have gotten into the art school he wanted to get into before he, you know, when he was young? And so the book is like divided into like alternative chapters where you have on the one hand Hitler, who is like the actual Hitler, and he did a lot of biographical research about what, you know, what Hitler did and all that. And then you have like the other alternative way that the book takes, where he calls him Adolf, okay, just to make the difference, you know, clear in the mind of the reader, and where he tries to imagine what would have happened, not only to that person but to the whole world, if Adolf would have got in that school. Okay, and so in that book there is a very interesting passage that speaks about this idea that the we, the preoccupation of the common good, could very well be considered as a source of evil as well. It says that, I'm just gonna like take some excerpts and try to translate them as I speak, and let's do it. So it says, no one is willingly evil. Well, that's not new, and it's not Eric Emmanuel Schmidt who invented that. Plato said it a long time ago, Socrates as well. Bon. No one is willingly evil. All people believe they act for the good, what they consider good. I believe there are two sorts of monsters on this earth. The one who only think about themselves, and the one who only think about others. In other words, the egoist assholes and the altruist assholes. The altruist assholes provoke way more disaster, because nothing will stop them. Not the pleasure, not the self-satisfaction, not money, not glory. Why? Because the altruist asshole doesn't think of anything else but others. They go beyond the frame of the private, you know, maleficence. They do big political careers. They wipe their hands full of blood in the rag of their ideals. I'm gonna stop here because it's so hard to translate like as I speak. But you see the point. I like this difference between, like, you know, the egoistical asshole, the one who thinks only about himself and is, you know, self-driven, but also the altruistic asshole, really is convinced deeply that he's acting for the common good. And that's something, that's a problem that I think Hannah Arendt should have addressed as well. To conclude, Nietzsche and Arendt, I think, both warn us against the dangers, one, of leaving unquestioned the genealogy of evil, that was more Nietzsche, and of refusing to explain it by referring to some mysterious, unexplainable dark force, right? They suggest actually to explore ways of exploring where evil as a stigmatizing concept comes from, but also places where the responsibility of evil acts can themselves come from. That would be Arendt. So Nietzsche, on the one hand, helped us to see that ascriptions of evil can be made by victimizing people that basically demonize other people they envy. Evil for Nietzsche doesn't refer to anything objective, it's just an adjective noun we use to stigmatize someone or something. Judgment that indicate a negative life-denying perspective. So with Nietzsche, we focused more on the psychological or affective origin of our Western morality. And with Arendt, we turned to the social and political factors that can generate evil on a grand scale. Instead of qualifying people themselves as evil, Arendt turns against the mediocrity generated by institutions, political and social structures that might lead us to give up on our ability to question authority, to think for ourselves critically. Thank you very much. Do you have questions? Yes.
That the individual who does choose to think is inherently good in the sense that if you think, you will always come to the right conclusion. Because it kind of seems like she assumes like inherent morality. It's just that
by saying that some people are more mediocre naturally than others, This is very true. Huh. And that's something that actually came up to me when I was just preparing this afternoon. Somehow, even if she refuses to admit it, she would never admit it. Mm-hmm. You cannot understand what she's saying if there is not some inner, already innate mediocrity somehow in Eichmann already. So she's always blaming the institution, but she cannot only do that, she has to blame Eichmann. And so she's always like plays this game between the two, trying to find responsibility in both, but insisting more, because that's convenient for her, on the fact that institutions, she doesn't say generates, she says encourages the mediocrity of Eichmann. So if it encourages, that means it was already there to a certain point. And those, some people are more or less mediocre than others. Yes, that would be a good criticism against Arendt, definitely. Yes, something, a flaw that she didn't address. Yes?
You know, Arendt, in her book on revolution, discusses how people in the 19th century kind of, they lost the distinction between democracy and republic. And for a long time, a democracy was not really an ideology, it was simply considered a form of government. And the founding fathers of the US, for example, were very mistrustful of pure democracy because they thought in a republic, the public spirit is likely to prevail, whereas in a pure democracy, public opinion is likely to prevail, and that can be a very, very dangerous thing. So, I mean, I tend to view Hannah Arendt as something of a conservative, at least in the 19th century sense, in that she didn't trust pure democracy, and that the distinction in her thought is not necessarily between totalitarianism and democracy, because they can have things in common. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You got that? That was very good. Yeah, that's why she traces back, when you read her, she's also actually drawing a parallel between totalitarianism and our society today as a technician industrialized society that again segmented authority and people just, you know, try to belong to the mass and basically, and that's also what Tocqueville very well pointed out when he writes about Democracy in America, which is one of his books, where he's actually pointing out that, you know, the reign of the opinion like this is also extremely mind-numbing and dangerous as well. Yes, which is why it's interesting to read her today, because it warns us also from our society today that evil can just emerge anytime, so to say. Yes.
Oh, okay. Does she speak at all about like religious faith and kind of like the deference of responsibility or free thinking in that sense? Like the whole concept of faith, like you're just supposed to like not question something. Does she speak about like religion as an institution?
not to my knowledge, which is limited, I'm not a specialist of Hannah Arendt. Also, I think for strategical reasons, because again, Eichmann, you know, you had all the Jewish communities, different Jewish communities, you know, around it at this trial that actually she also did, she had a lot of criticism against that trial as well, that I can go over if you want, like the fact that, you know, the Mossad went to Argentina, got the guy, that was not lawful at all to begin with. I mean, if you want to focus on pure law, no, it wasn't. They captured the guy, they put it in there, in that this theater kind of thing where he looked just like an animal in a cage, kind of, you know, it was a whole setting, so to say, that she criticized it a lot. But she, it was so linked to like the Jewish people that I think she wouldn't have dared to say a word about religion at this point. But maybe if, you know, if she would have had the time to speak about religious faith, she probably would have seen some kind of dogmatism as well in that. I think so. I think that's what she would, from, you know, what I know about her, that's how what I would deduct. But again, I'm not sure. Yes?
I'm sort of curious about thoughtlessness, the way that is framed.
It's thoughtlessness. I think it sounded more like a lack of emotional intelligence when someone's thoughtless. And if we think about like attachment with imagery in the brain of like who we attach to in a secure base, why sometimes the imagery becomes this government versus the person next to me. You know, if we come from hunters and gatherers, this is what we're attached to in our parents and so forth. Mm-hmm. But sometimes that gets deflected into these other ideas and things.
Alors, non, because you know, she actually says, for instance, that Eichmann would never have killed his superior. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Oh, that actually, that right. goes what you, what
right,
we
yeah,
was,
yeah.
yeah, like, in his head, he was certainly not a murderer. He would never have touched like a hair of his, you know, colleague or whatever,
right.
you know?
Yeah.
So there is also the distanciation of, you know, the murder and that allowed that for it to happen. But it's not so much he had an emotional connection with his peers, so to say. The thoughtlessness here is really more the ability to judge critically and morally from a universal perspective. I think that's, you know, the type of thought that she says Eichmann is missing entirely, and that a lot of people are missing and are trained to miss when they are under a totalitarian rule.
Universally, does that mean individuals?
No, universally.
Just
everyone, precisely.
Everyone, yeah, yeah.
Everyone.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
Not only the people next to you yeah. because you care about them and they're in
right.
your daily life,
right.
but also everyone. And that he wasn't able to do. That's the we, she says, we need. In
yeah.
thinking.
So I think that with banal, if I'm pronouncing that right, that sounds like if you're not connected with another person or nature, because these are tangible things next to us, then, you know, it's problematic, it's not original, it's an issue.
She doesn't address the problem of like the psychopath, if that's what you're trying to reach, like the person who doesn't feel any like empathy, emotional connection.
Well, I think with the thoughtlessness and like the lack of emotionality for the universal experience, right, then you're starting to connect to other things that are not the universe, universal connection of other humans.
Like what?
I love this TV show and I praise anyone who likes that TV show, right? They're friends of mine, but like otherwise it's not like the person that I'm actually friends with around. I only like this group or that, this political identity.
Yeah, I mean, just to go back to your initial question, the thoughtlessness for her is just the inability promoted by certain political institutions, the inability to be able to take a step above, so to say, and be able to be concerned and think critically about the authority that you're underneath, mm-hmm. okay, and to be concerned on the universal good, okay, mm-hmm. which is very hard to do nonetheless, mm-hmm. but we should always be trained to do that, and totalitarian regimes obviously train you not to do that. Yes.
You might be aware of what you're doing, but you're acting out of fear, and that's your mediocrity because you never really stand in within the hierarchy you operate. And it's not necessarily thoughtlessness. I'm sure he gave it some thought, and I'm sure he was. Quite happy with the position that was given to him. And that was, you know, and so it's hard to denies responsibility just in the name of him being part of a system, because he could still, at any moment, even as a mediocre man, rise up and say, oh, no, that I can't do, I don't want to be part of. Mm. But there is ambition, so it's just like, strictly, it's his small will to power that operates there.
Mediocre will to power, so to say. Yeah. Absolutely, yeah. And she speaks about that, about the fact that he was just, you know, this kind of man that never got like a good job before, never was, you know, he didn't have any talent, he was never acknowledged by anyone, and all of a sudden he gets like this good job within, you know, a pretty good job and with a lot of responsibility. That obviously flatters his ego. So that's also where the mediocrity lies. Absolutely, yes.
What does she say about the individuals who enjoy the suffering of others? So, because, you know, she's putting them as cogs in a system, but what if those cogs enjoy inflicting pain just for the act of inflicting pain?
Okay, so about sadist, basically, sadism. Okay, like the enjoying seeing people suffering.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure that was very common. That's what she would say, at least. That type of evil? That type of evil, she doesn't, actually, I think doesn't, I don't know what she would say. Probably say that it's a type of disease of some sort, which would make her fall back into a traditional conception of evil, namely like madness, irrationality, something that's not explainable again. She doesn't address that type of evil. She addresses the type of evil that can have huge genocidal proportions, namely like the type of evil that, you know, the Holocaust was. But she doesn't address like more like individually, very rarely, the type of people who would be enjoying watching people suffer. That doesn't happen very often. Most people who commit evil acts are basically acting out of their own benefit and pleasure, but they're not obligatory finding pleasure in the suffering of others. They're finding pleasure in something that accidentally make other people suffer, but they're not specifically enjoying that. I mean, except Sad, which gave his name to sadism, right? I'm not sure, but that's, anyway. I'm not sure. And if he was, it was because he was mind numb to the fact that they were also human beings, in a way. So he was so drawn into his own ideology of like serving the human race for the greater good, etc., making the human race better. So deeply convinced about that, that he was acting for good, not out of the pleasure he would feel at seeing them suffer.
Did she read Nietzsche? Of course.
Yeah. Yes, he did.
And so he could be, in his own mind, consider himself as an Übermensch.
Absolutely. Oui. Like the embodiment of like the new human race, basically. Yeah.
Yeah, just to support where you were going with that, I think like that would feed into the thoughtlessness part, to enjoy someone suffering, right? Because that would be like a lack of understanding and not really thinking critically about the effects, really, and just.
Probably, yeah. That's one way of seeing it. But again, I think like any time there is a, you see, like Hitler didn't kill the Jews for the pleasure of killing the Jews. He killed the Jews because he had a great goal for humanity. You know what I'm saying? So, and every time you look at evil acts, you always have the motive is always somehow related to a good, which is what, you know, the quote of the book I read is about. Like, no one is doing evil willingly. You don't do evil for the sake of evil. You do evil for the sake of a certain good that is going to have some evil consequences that you're oblivious of, basically.
Okay, we have time for only one more question.
Yeah, one more question. Okay, I don't know where. I don't choose. I don't know. Okay.
Earlier you mentioned the egotistic asshole and the altruistic asshole. And I was curious about the altruistic assholes, the ones that care about others. Who are they?
Hitler.
Yeah.
Great example. Stalin. Great example. these people, as the book says, do great political careers. They are so convinced that they're acting for the good of others that they're going to try anything possible to make sure that we better the human race, that we, you know, it's just this deep conviction, which is why these are extremely dangerous, obviously, because they're not even... You cannot bribe them, for instance, these people. You cannot say, okay, take that money. That's the egoist asshole. He's fine. You give him some money, he's going to shut up. He's going to stop, you know, doing evil, okay? Because he cares about himself. But people who don't care about themselves but the good of others are able of the worst atrocities. And that's why she say, thinking is also to be able to doubt, to be able to not have certitudes, to be able to not build dogmatic, you know, opinions in your head and make sure that you always question what you judge as, you know, the good of humanity, for instance.
Yes.
So if we have egotistic on one hand and we have altruistic on the other hand, and then we have totalitarianism on one side and we have democratic on the other side.
No. Democratic and totalitarianism can also be on the same side.
Okay. Oui. Yeah.
Yes.
How?
Wait. Yeah. If democracy becomes a regime where, you know, your abilities to think becomes numb, which I think our democracy is pretty close to, I'm not going to compare the democracy we live in with, you know, Nazi regime, obviously, but there is a certain numbness. People don't go vote. I mean, there is a disinterest for the common good in the sense that Hannah Arendt speaks of. Namely, like just being concerned about how we just, you know, we just think about authorities and all this instead of just leading our little conformist life, so to say. Okay? So she doesn't oppose democracy and totalitarianism. She says that actually democracy, the way it looks at the time she writes, can very well fall into totalitarianism easily. Okay, I think that's, unfortunate. But you can come to see afterwards, to see me. Thank you very much for your attention, guys.